Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon, and welcome to Coral Ridge Presbyterian Church. You are in for a musical feast today. As you can see, there are 16 brass and percussion musicians who will give you the amazing and beautiful and powerful sound of glorious music. And by the way, if any of you have hearing aids, you might want to turn them down. I want to begin by reading from Scripture. Now, this is talking about the dedication of Solomon's temple. This is from the book of 2 Chronicles, the 5th chapter, verses 12 through 14. And there are Bibles in your pews if you want to follow along. The Levites, who were the singers, all of them with their sons and their brethren, being arrayed in white linen, having cymbals and psalteries and harps, stood at the east end of the altar, and with them 120 priests sounding with trumpets. I'm going to say that again. 120 priests sounding with trumpets. Now, just imagine that. It came to pass, as the trumpeters and the singers, and we can only imagine that if they have 120 trumpeters, that they would have had hundreds of singers, maybe even thousands, were as one to make one sound to be heard in praising and thanking the Lord. And when they lifted up their voice with the trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music, and praise the Lord, saying, "For he is good, for his mercy endureth forever." Now listen to this. Then the house was filled with a cloud, even the house of the Lord, so that the priests could not stand to minister by reason of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord had filled the house of God. Now, is that the definition of awesome or what? That's amazing. I think in the history of the earth, there was no better definition of the word awesome. We do not have 120 trumpets, but we do have more brass players than usual, and I hope you will be blessed by this wonderful music. These musicians have all volunteered an enormous amount of time to prepare for this concert, and we are all very appreciative. Would we all thank them, please? Psalm 150 tells us to praise him with the sound of the trumpet, to praise him with loud cymbals, and to praise him with organs, sometimes translated as pipes. We have all three, and we will obey God's command. Will you join me in prayer? Awesome God, our Father, we thank you for the gift of music and the joy and blessing that music has given to millions of people through the ages. We thank you for inspiring composers to write this beautiful music. We ask you to bless this concert, and we pray that it may be a blessing to those who are here, as well as those listening on live stream. In Christ's name, amen. Thank you.
turn silent.
Check. There we go. Good afternoon. On behalf of the Flamingo Brass, Dr. Wiltson, Coleridge Church, thank you for being here. I'm Jeff Carroll, and it's my pleasure to be the guest conductor of the Flamingo Brass today. This group of ladies and gentlemen were founded by the first trombone player, Mr. Mark Edwards, during the COVID lockdown, and he did this. And he did this, he created this group especially so that his friends, brass musicians, had a chance to continue to play. On their Facebook page, it says, "We went into COVID, unsure of our future as musicians. We finally came together and have been granted a chance to enjoy music again. We are a combination of a brass quintet, a brass octet, a brass choir, depending on the music we put together." I asked Mark how they came about the name Flamingo Brass. And he informed me that his wife named the group after their first performance, which was at Flamingo Gardens in Davie. So you get the connection there, okay? So that's how they came up with their name. I am certain that when anyone ever enters the sanctuary for the very first time, the first thing they notice is that organ. And certainly the first music they hear is from that organ. And that's usually followed by the word, wow. In my own opinion, this organ is the second most important part of our corporate worship here at Coleridge, as it leads us in song and praises, second only to the preaching of God's word from that pulpit over there. A little later in the program, Dr. Wilson's going to talk about the renovations needed to be done to ensure that this magnificent organ can continue to be playable, but I shared with him, and he asked me to share with you my story about the organ. I can remember the first day I walked into the sanctuary. I was a music student from the University of Miami. It was back in the 1970s. I heard that organ play. I heard that chancel choir sing. And I believe my first word was, wow, followed by, I've got to play here. Within a few short weeks, I was given the opportunity to do just that, and I am so thankful that it has not stopped since then. My wife and I were drawn here to the church by the music and the opportunity to perform, and because of that, the Lord allowed me to become the band director at Westminster Academy, the church's school, across the street for 41 years. I know that there are other similar stories of how this organ has made such an impression on people that they have become part of the ministry here also. This instrument is extremely important to us and our guest musicians who perform here, who usually, and in fact, the first rehearsal we had in here, come in and they say, wow, because that's what it is. I can tell you it's a real treat for them to play, and countless musicians share that each year in all the concerts that we do when they come in and are able to play with this organ. Dr. Wilson's going to perform Bach's Toccata in Fugue in D minor. This piece is famous for many reasons. Part of it is because it is a great piece of music. Also, it's been used in countless movies. But also, it's used as a major testing tool for both organs and organists. The word toccata in Italian means to touch. This type of instrument piece was designed to highlight the performer's technical ability. Literally, how well the player could touch the instrument, and additionally, how well the instrument can respond to that touch. In a few minutes, Dr. Wilson will give you some insight on what was necessary for him to do today to touch this instrument and make it playable. Dr. Wilson.
Thank you.
Now, I know what some of you are thinking right now. You're probably thinking, the organ sounds wonderful. Why are they talking about an organ restoration fund? How many of you have had a roof that developed a leak? Quite a few, yes. You all know that if you have a leak in your roof, you need to fix it because that leak will get bigger and bigger. And not only that, but there will be many more leaks, right? Right? Well, the organ is the same way. And this organ is almost 50 years old. And as you can see from the information that was given you, there are approximately 7,000 pipes. And the pipes that you see here and the ones behind these 7,000 pipes will pretty much last for centuries. The pipes don't go bad. Unfortunately, the mechanism under the pipes that controls whether they're on or off does go bad. But 50 years is a long time. But that time has come. And now we need to do something about it before that roof leak turns into a flood. Now, the leaks that we have are not water leaks, they're air leaks. And underneath all those 7,000 pipes, there are little leather pouches with leather and some cork, both of which go bad after this amount of time. It's actually pretty remarkable that they last even that long. The reason that the organ sounds good is because my wife and I spend a great deal of time trying to work things out to make it sound good. You can't just play anything. So I'm going to give you a little brief example. And bear in mind, this is only a small fraction of the things. Now, one of the loudest stops on the organ is this trumpet in the pedal. And I'm going to play a scale. Do you know what happens when the leathers go bad? It becomes a dead note. So listen again. That's two notes in one octave. And unfortunately, it's hard to cover that up. And if you were really sharp, you might have noticed it here and there as I was playing, but I tried to cover it up. And the way we cover it up is that we add more stops on top of it. We don't play that stop by itself because obviously that wouldn't work. So now listen to another one, okay? Oh, I'm sorry, I played the wrong octave. Okay. There's the dead note. Okay, now, in the antiphonal organ, just to give you something different, listen to this. quite a few dead notes. So I can't play that stop by itself. Now, over here in the choir, I pull out this viola, which is a stop you use almost all the time. And guess what? It doesn't play at all, except for the bottom octave, which is on a different wind chest. That works, but I can't use this at all. Now listen to this. This is supposed to be a flute. Now, that's not a flute. That's a flute combined with a mixture, which is a very high-sounding stop. And if you want just a flute, you don't want a high-sounding stop of a mixture along with it. And nobody's sure why that happens. And then, as I was telling somebody, the Lord has a sense of humor. And today, mind you, I found a set of 8 stops that has a dead note right here. Now listen to this. Now, if you have one stop that has a dead note, you can cover that up. If you have 8 stops, then that's a little harder. By the way, have you ever heard the, you probably used the expression, pull out all the stops? Well, you may not have realized, but that comes from the organ. And several times during this program, we pull out all the stops. Now, I told you that we have leaky air, and a lot of the reservoirs in here that control the air, big things, have a lot of leather on them. Leather is leaking, and it makes a lot of noise. I'd like you to be very quiet, and you probably hear it. You hear a hissing, and you're probably thinking it's the air conditioner. It's not. It's the organ. Listen, there's a series of like Venetian blinds in front of the organ pipes where you control the volume, so listen. Now that's what the organ should sound like, but the organ maintenance men tell me that there's a hole in the in one of the reservoirs of bellows that's the size of your fist. And they're astounded that the organ pipes still play. And that's the majority of that noise that you hear. And unfortunately, it little by little gets bigger and bigger. So I won't bore you with anything more, but I just want you to know that we're kind of at a critical point where we have to do something or we'll have, like the roof, we're going to have a flood. So if you can help us, we'd be very appreciative. As you leave, we're trying to be COVID friendly, so we're not going to pass the offering plate, but as you leave, there'll be in the back there some ushers with offering plates, and if you can help us, and then there are information about giving in the little program that you have. Thank you very, very much. Most of you know Dr. Kennedy's daughter, Jennifer Kennedy Cassidy, and we have a video. She wasn't able to be here tonight, but she recorded a video, and she's very enthusiastic about this project, and I hope the video is ready.
Good afternoon, and thank you for coming to this organ benefit concert. I'm Jennifer Kennedy Cassidy, and I'm the daughter of Dr. and Mrs. D. James Kennedy. I've grown grown up in this church, and this is where I've come to learn and appreciate good music and the pipe organ. If you knew my mom and dad, you know that they both had a love for music and were both musicians. My mom played the piano and the clarinet. She was a soprano soloist and taught music at Birmingham Southern College after she graduated. My dad played the saxophone and the clarinet and went to college on a clarinet scholarship. In his downtime in his younger days, he played in a nightclub band on the weekends. This church is known all around the world for its outstanding church music program because my folks made it their priority to develop an outstanding music program. My dad took Psalm 150 seriously, where it says, "Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the trumpet sound. Praise him with lute and harp. Praise him with tambourine and dance. Praise him with strings and pipes. Praise him with sounding cymbals. Praise him with loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord." Our Rufati pipe organ was designed by Diane Bish, our organist emeritus here at Coral Ridge. It is a magnificent instrument, and it is one of the larger church pipe organs in the United States. It's nearly 50 years old and has been hard at work all of those years. It is used in all the worship services and most of the special services held in the sanctuary. In addition, it is usually the anchor in a lot of our programs as part of the concert series. Our patriotic concerts and Christmas programs all use the organ just like you're enjoying this afternoon. But not only is this pipe organ used to make music, it also has a ministry of its own. Did you know that people from all over the world come here to see and hear this organ? And when they come, they also hear the good news of Jesus Christ. Let me tell you about one man that came to hear the organ. He had heard about it, and so he decided to come one Sunday and check it out. Shortly thereafter, a few folks from the church went to his home to get acquainted, and they led him and his wife to Christ. He then became involved in the Evangelism Explosion program and became a teacher trainer. He went all around the world teaching people how to share their faith. He became an elder, and he was one of the men that started the television ministry here. He served on several of the boards of the organizations that my dad started, and the list of what he accomplished for the Lord goes on and on, all because he wanted to come and hear the organ at Coral Ridge. This church has always supported the arts and has always been committed to musical training for the children of the church. Many young people have taken organ lessons here and practiced on this organ for many hours. What an opportunity for a young person to be able to have access to such a fine instrument. We have a family right here in this church whose daughter studied organ for most of her growing up years. She's now at Juilliard in the organ program. Most likely, she wouldn't have had this opportunity without this magnificent organ. As you can see, this organ is not just an instrument installed in this beautiful sanctuary for interior design purposes. It is an active part of worship and ministry of this church. I hope now you can see why this organ needs some restoration work and maintenance. We need to raise $1 million for this project. $650,000 is what is needed for the pipes and the inner workings of the organ. And we need another $250,000 for the console, which controls it. I hope you will consider helping with this effort so we can all continue to enjoy the beautiful music it provides to every service and concert. If we all help, we will reach our goal without difficulty. But it requires all of us to be all in. I'm in. Join me in the bright future for this beautiful instrument.
Thank you.
The next selection on your program this afternoon is going to be by the Flamingo Brass themselves, and it's titled First Gift, and it's going to be conducted by their regular conductor, Juan Manzilla. Would you welcome Juan to the podium? Juan.